Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us in an ayah. An ayah in the Quran which Imam Qurtubi rahimahullah ta'ala, he says about, لَمْ أَرَى أَشَدُّ مِنْهَا. I've not found a stronger or more severe warning in a verse other than this verse in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that verse is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Say, tell them, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنْ كَانَ آبَاءُكُمْ. If your fathers and your sons and your brothers and your wives and your kin people and the wealth which you've gathered and the houses which you live or dwell in and you're pleased with and more beloved to you than Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and jihad in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fatarabbasu, wait. The ulama of tafsir, they say, wait li'uquba. Wait for a punishment, ajila wa ajila, an immediate punishment or delayed punishment. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ended the ayah by saying, Wallahu la yahdi al-qawm al-fasiqeen. Allah does not guide the fusaq. Once Umar was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his hand was in the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, innaka la ahab. You are the most beloved to me, more than everything except for my own self. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no Umar, no, until I swear by the one, my soul is in his hand, until I'm more beloved to you than your own self. At this point, Umar radiallahu an, he said, al-an, right now, verily you're more beloved to me than my own self. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, al-an ya Umar, right, this is the right thing now, Umar. Anas radiallahu an, in Mesha Hadith, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever has three qualities will find the sweetness of Iman. And one of those qualities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is more beloved to him than everything else. And once a person asks the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when is the hour? When is the day of judgment? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him that, what have you prepared? He said, not much, except I love Allah and I love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Anta ma'a man ahbabta. You be with the one who you love. Anas, the narrator of the hadith, he said, Ma farihna bi shay'in. We have never, as the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we've never become happy as we became happy with this hadith. Why were they happy? He said, Fa inni uhibbu Rasulullah. I love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa uhibbu Abu Bakr wa Umar. And I love Abu Bakr and Umar, to show us from loving the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to love his companions. That I love these people, fa arju, so therefore I am hopeful. An akuna ma'ahum wa in lam a'mal bi a'malihim. Even if I didn't do what they did in actions, I have a great hope I'll be with these people because of this love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in the first ayah, the ulama such as Qadi Iyad, he said, wa kafa bihadhi al-ayah. This ayah is sufficient, hadhan, as a portion, wa tanbihan, and as an attention, an alert, wa hujja wa dalala, a proof and evidence, ala luzum mahabbati rasulillah, as a proof for the obligation to love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam al-Sa'idi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, hadhi al-ayah kareema a'zamu dalil. This verse is the greatest evidence in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ala wujubi mahabbati rasulillah, the obligation to love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and not just to love him, wa taqdimuha yani mahabbatuhu ala mahabbati kulli shay, to put the love of Allah and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam above all other things. My brothers and sisters, there are many ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ni'm, for min ni'matillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala, is al-alam, is pain. Because when you feel pain, it's warning you. It's a signal something is not right. So you find the most destructive of diseases, such as cancer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from that. Until it becomes terminal or it's too late, that's when you feel the pain. The most destructive diseases. Likewise, when it comes to spiritual diseases, there's things we do not feel, but they are destructive to us spiritually. And one of those things that we may not feel that's missing from us is love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And how do we know this is missing from us? What is the litmus test? How do we know this? Is that somebody diabetic? How does he know he's diabetic? He goes for a blood test, urine test, and they test him. How do we know this? What is the litmus test? Love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The proof of it is what? Al-ittiba', to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the litmus test, if you want to see, do I love Allah, is to follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِ. Say, if you love Allah, then follow me. And we as an ummah will never become rectified. Our affairs will never become rectified, except for rectify the first generation. And that which rectified the first generation, the Sahaba and those who came after them, was love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And ittiba', following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we have many, many examples. Maybe this khutbah cannot even cover, but we'll mention a few of these examples. From this example of the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is that after the battle of Uhud, when the news and the rumor had spread that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been killed, the people of Medina, the Muslims, came out to get news of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, out of love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And amongst them was a woman. And all she asked when the people were coming, despite that her father was in the battle, her brother was in the battle, her son was in the battle, the first thing she asked when the Mujahideen came back, ماذا فعل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم? What has happened to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم? They said to her, مات أبوك. Your father has died. What did she say? She said, ماذا فعل رسول الله? How is the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم? They said to her, مات أخوك. Your brother has died. She said, ماذا فعل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم? What has happened to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم? They said to her, مات ابنك. Your son has died. She said, ماذا فعل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم? How is the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم? At this point, they realized this is what she was concerned about. They said to her, he is okay. She said, I'm not going to rest حتى أراه, until I see him. After she saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with her own eyes, she said, "Kullu masa'ib ba'daka jalal." Any calamity after you is insignificant. Some might say this is sentiments and emotion, but this is a person that has just been told about the death of her husband, the death of her son, the death of her brother. And you find this in the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, that the greatest calamity is to lose the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned a hadith. And when he mentioned this hadith, baka Abu Bakr buka'an shadidan. Abu Bakr cried severely. Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, the narrator of the hadith, he said, I was wondering, what's wrong with the Shaykh, yani Abu Bakr? Why is he crying? He said, kan a'lamuna. He was the most knowledgeable of us, Abu Bakr. So he knew the meaning of the hadith. And that hadith, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna rajulan khayyarahu Allah bayna zahrat hayati dunya wa ma indahu fakhtara ma indah." That Allah has given a man a choice of the adornments of the life of this world or that which is with him. And what does this mean? The departure of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When Abu Bakr, he heard this, he cried. He knew the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was about to pass away. So he said, fadaynaka bi abaina wa ummahatina. We're ready to sacrifice our fathers and our mothers for you, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is not just lip service, they would do it. Because Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, his father, Abu Quhafa, when he accepted Islam, what joy for Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu that your father has accepted Islam. But when Abu Talib passed away, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did Abu Bakr say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And when he passed away, Abu Talib as a kafir, as a disbeliever, he said, I would have loved for your uncle to be in my father's position and for my father to be in your uncle's position. Subhanallah. Look at the love of the Sahaba for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That I wish your uncle accepted Islam and not my father. Look at this love. And out of this love, they used to love to honor the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam arrived in Medina, he descended or arrived in the house of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. And Abu Ayyub al-Ansari had a house, as we mentioned in the seerah, of two stories, two floors house, or two-story house. So he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you stay on the upper floor, I'll stay on the lower floor. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as-suflu arfaqu bina, yakhshani ashabi. The lower floor is better because I'm going to receive many visitors. So he stayed on the lower floor. Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, he said, fa idhan taba'tu, Because I was on the upper floor. He said, I paid attention, I noticed. أَمْشِي عَلَى سَقِيفَ تَحْتَهَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ I'm walking on a ceiling and under it is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَجَمَعْتُ I said, I just confined myself to one corner of the house. Subhanallah. He could not walk upon the ceiling, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is belated. He said, one day, a vessel which would contain water, you know, store water, it broke. He said, we brought up every single cloth we had in the house. And we had no other clothes to dry the house. حتى لا ينزل أو تنزل قطرة على رسول الله. That not even a single drop should drop on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Ayyub al Ansari, he said, I used to send food to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وكنا لا نأكل إلا بعده. We would never eat except after him. He said, one day I sent food to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. ففزعت. I was shocked. He sent it back. So he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the food he had sent back was onion. He said, أَهْرَامٌ هُ Is it haram? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا, لَأَنَّكَ لَا تُنَاجِ مَنْ أُنَاجِ You do not speak to those who I speak to. And who are these? The angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it was not haram. But Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, he said, مَا جَرَمَ So long as you hate it, I also hate it. Even though it's not haram. So long as you hate it, I hate it. They used to honor the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another example is the Battle of Khandaq. In the Battle of Khandaq, when they were digging the trenches, Anas, Afwan, Jabir ibn Abdullah, he said, ظَلَلْنَا ثَلَاثَ أَيَّامٍ مَا ذُقْنَا ذَوَاقًا 3 days passed, we didn't eat a single thing. For 3 days. He said, we came across a sakhra, a heavy rock, and we had to break the rock. None of us had the strength to do it. So we went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, when I reached the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tied around his stomach was a stone. And what was the purpose of the stone? To ward off the pains of hunger. And not only could he see the stone around the stomach of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, رَأَيْتُ عَلَى وَجِهِ أَجُوعَ I could see hunger on the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was extremely hungry. He said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with mi'war to break the rock. He said, Bismillah, and the rock became like dust. So Jabir ibn Abdullah, after they said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَتَأْذَنْ لِي أَنْ أَذْهَبِ إِلَى الْبَيْتِ Can you allow me to go home? He didn't tell the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam what he's about to do. So he went to his wife and said, مَاذَا عِنْدَكِ مِنَ الطَّعَامِ What do you have from food? He said, قَدْ رَأَيْتُ شَيْئًا مَا لِي صَبْرَ عَلَيْهِ I have witnessed, I have seen something today I could not be patient with. You know what he saw today? That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was hungry. He said, I could not bear with this. His wife said to him, we've only got a handful of wheat. A handful of wheat. And one small goat. But we will sacrifice that. But she warned him before he left. She said, إِيَّاكَ أَن تَفْضَحَنِي أَمَامَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ مَعَهُ She said, do not embarrass me, shame me in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and those with him. فَلَا تَأْتِ بِأَلْفُ رَجُلٍ Do not bring 1,000 people. Just bring a small group of people. So Jabir radiallahu anhu said, فَذَهَبْتُ فَسَرَلْتُ I went and I gave the glad tidings to the Prophet secretly told him, I've got food. So he said, فَإِذَا all of a sudden بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يُنَادِ أَهْلَ الْخَنْدَقِ هَلُمُّ قَدْ صَنَعَ جَابِرْ لَكُمْ طَعَامِ He said, all of a sudden the Prophet started to scream to people in the tent, come, 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 Jabir has prepared food for all of you. He said, وَاللَّهِ أَدْرَكَنِ مِنَ الْحَيَاءِ مَا لَا يَعْلَمُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ He said, I was overcome by such embarrassment that none knows but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, do not put the food on the fire until I come to you. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reached the house of Jabir ibn Abdullah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he spat into the meat and he made dua and barakah. And likewise the dough. Jabir radiallahu anhu said, فَأُقْسِمُ بِاللَّهِ قَدْ أَكَلُوا وَتَحَوَّلُوا He said, they ate so much, and they turned away from the food and the meat remained as it was. And they kept baking the dough remained as it was. And you know what Jabir radiallahu anhu said in that hadith? He said, كَانَ أَلْفُ رَجْعَ And there's 1,000 of us. 1,000 men. But the point from this hadith is the love of Jabir radiallahu anhu for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمِنْ أَبْرَزِ ذَلِكَ From the most apparent of this is Sulh Hudaybiyah. In Sulh Hudaybiyah, one of the Quraysh was a kafir at that time, Urwa ibn Mas'ud al-Thaqafi. He said to the Quraysh, let me go and see what's with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They sent him as a ayn, jasus, a spy. So he went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that la in turidu, if what you want Muhammad, is to fight the Quraysh وتنتصر عليهم ما استباح أحد من قبلك قوما. Nobody before you has made the blood of his people halal. But I warn you, if your plan doesn't work, لا أرى حولك. I cannot see anybody around you, because he looked at the Sahaba hungry. They were tired. You could see poverty. He said, I don't see anybody around you except for riffraffs. If the Quraysh turn on you, these people abandon you. At this point, one of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, he said, نَتْرُكُهُ وَنَدَعَهُ. We're going to leave him and abandon him. He said, أُمْسُسْ بَضْرَ اللَّاتِ. A word I could not say here. He insulted them with such a bad insult. Urwa was shocked. He said, مَنْ قَالَ هَذَا? Who said this? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and he smiled, Ibn Abi Quhafa, the son of Abu Quhafa, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Urwa was from the chiefs of Quraysh. He said, لَوْلَا كَانَتْ لَكَ يَدُ عَلَيْهِ جَاهِلِيَ لَا يَجَبْتُ. If it wasn't the fact that I know you from Jahiliyyah and what you've done for me, I would have answered you. At this point again, Urwa continued to negotiate with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until he started to stroke the beard of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as the Arabs do sometimes, stroke each other's beard. But the Sahaba could not stand this. It's not good manners with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So one of the Sahaba, a young man, he was fully covered, his face was fully masked, and he had a sword in his hand. Every time Urwa would strike the beard of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to stroke it, he would strike him with the sword on his hand. So Urwa would forget himself, he would hit him on the hand. Urwa became disturbed. He said, Man hadha? Who is this person? Az'ajani. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled, said, Hadha ibn akhik. This is the son of your brother. Urwa was shocked. Not only is the son of his brother, he said, Ghudar, you the treacherous one. Ma ziltu as'a fi ghudratika. Till this very day, I'm paying for your treachery. You know what the treachery was? The Sahabi, Mughira ibn Shu'bah, was the nephew of Urwa. He had killed 13 people. They were drunk and he killed all 13 people. He took all their wealth and he went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, I want to become a Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to show his amana, said, Amma al-Islam aqbaluhu mink. As for Islam, I accept it. As for the wealth, I can't take it because he's brought with treachery. But now there remained one issue. He killed 13 men from another tribe. So the tribe now, they wanted to kill Urwa. His uncle had to pay the blood money for each and every single man. And he was still paying it to that very day. So he's shocked. I did this for you. And you're the one striking my hand with a sword. After this, Urwa radiallahu anhu, he started to look at the action of the companions. And this is why I said, Hadh min abraziha, from the most apparent of it. And I'll read it as Urwa radiallahu anhu, he mentioned. Urwa, he mentioned, after what happened with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَفَدْتُ عَلَى الْمُلُوكِ. He said, I've gone past many kings, such as Kisra, Qaisar, and Najashi. He said, I have never seen a people who obey their kings as Muhammad is obeyed. He said, لَا يَرْفَعُونَ أَصْوَاتَهُمْ عِنْدَهُ. They will never raise their voice in his company. They could never look at him directly, out of awe and respect to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, لا يأمر بشيء إلا أشار إليه فيفعلونه. It will never give an order except it will just point and it will do it immediately. And he says, لا and nor would he spit or take out a phlegm from his throat. ويبسقو or spit except they will rush to grab the spit and rub it all over their body. Subhanallah. He said, ولا ينزل قطرة من وضوءه. Not a single drop of his wudu would drop on the floor. يَتَتِلُونَ عَلَيْهِ. They would rush to grab the wudu of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That would drip from him. He said, I've never seen this before. So he said to Quraysh, if he's to fight these people, he could not fight. They don't care what you're going to do to them. Look at this love of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is what made them successful. وَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ. Now this love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Sahaba understood that if they did not have it, فَتَرَبَّسُوا. Wait for a painful punishment, that the Prophet ﷺ had to be more beloved to them than their family. And the love of the Prophet was ittiba, to follow him. Not only to follow him, to go against anybody that went against the order of the Prophet ﷺ, even if it be their father or their son. So Abdullah ibn Umar, he told his son Bilal, a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that do not prevent the female servants of Allah from going to the masjid. His son said to him, La amna'an, I'm going to prevent them hun. I'm going to prevent them. Abdullah bin Umar, he looked at his son. He said, Uhadithuka. I am giving you a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and you're telling me this? He said, I will never speak to you again. He kicked him out of his house. He never spoke to his son or entered upon him until he died. He didn't even go to him when he died. This is how much the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam meant to them. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Wallahu la yahdi al-qawm al-fasiqeen. That Allah doesn't guide the evil livers. And the punishment for those who reject the sunnah, as we said, ajilatun ajila, will be in this dunya, humiliation, and in the akhirah. In this dunya wal akhirah. And the muhaddithin, the scholars of hadith, will know about the hadith of Prophet and the sunnah of Prophet. They had a special jealousy. One of them was ulama al-Nusr, one of the scholars of Egypt. One of the great, biggest muhaddithin of our time. Ahmad Shakir, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Ahmad Shakir, his son Muhammad Shakir was also a scholar. And at that time was the wakil of Azhar. So at the time of Malik Farooq, King Farooq had sent a man called Taha Hussein to Paris, and he was going to be honored on that particular day. So King Farooq prayed in the masjid. And the khatib, the person giving the khutbah, in praising King Farooq, what he's done by sending him to Paris and sponsoring him, in praising him, he said, look at this King Farooq. مَا عَبَسَ وَمَا تَوَلَّ أَنْ جَاهُ الْأَعْمَى. He never frowned, nor did he turn away when a blind person came to him. Astaghfirullah. Because Allah Ta'ala said about Prophet ﷺ, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّ. But as for King Farooq, he never frowned or turned away. Muhammad Shakir, the son of Ahmed Shakir, was in the khutbah. Before the khutbah could finish, he stood up. He said, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ أَعِيدُ صَلَاةَ جُمْعَ ظُهْرًا فَإِنَّ الْإِيمَانِ قَدْ كَفَرَ. O people, repeat Salatu Jumu'ah al-Dhuhr, because the Imam has left Islam. Immediately. When he said this, and remember, this is a Khatib of King Farooq, the case was raised against him to the court. So the only ulama they could go to, the official ulama, ulama of Azhar. He's the dean of Azhar. So he said, I don't want the scholars of Azhar. What I want you to do instead is for you to go to the non-Muslim orientalist and ask them, is this disrespectful to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? They knew they were going to lose the case. They dropped the case. Ahmed Shakir, his father, to show the result of those going against the Sunnah, he said, one day I was passing by a masjid. In places like Egypt and Nigeria, you have people that collect your shoes, you give them some money, and they sweep the floors in the masjid. He said, I passed by a masjid. I saw a man, he was collecting people's shoes on the floor. It was that same imam that had said that. Humiliation. Ajila. Once, a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that when you get up in your morning, wash your hands three times before you put it into the vessel, the food. A person said, because the Prophet said, La tadri, you do not know where your hand was. So one person said, I know where my hand was. Kanat ala sariri, it was on my bed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused his hand to become paralyzed immediately. So wujub, take away from this, the love, obligation for sallallahu, love of him is ittiba'u. Loving him is to follow him. Loving him is not to celebrate his birthday, which is a bid'ah. Loving him, if you truly love him, is ittiba'. Look at Majnunu Layla in his poetry. He went to the city, was kissing the walls in the city. He said, not because of the love of the walls, but the love of the person in the wall. So if we truly love the Prophet ﷺ, we should copy in all aspects of our life. We pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes of muhibbin li Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for those who love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for those who love the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and for those who love the scholars. Because the scholars, warathatul anbiya, they are the inheritors of the Prophet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us all, which is part of our love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of order that he began with himself, the angels, and thirdly, you believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna Allaha wa malaikata yusalluna ala al-Nabi, ya ayyuha alladhina sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad, kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, innaka hamidun majid.